for the exercise of care in eating. Two basic reasons. The first of these is to eat such foods as guarantee that you receive all of the necessary nutritive elements in adequate quantities and proper proportions. The other reason for care is that you eat under such conditions and in such manner as assure the highest degree of efficiency in digestion. For it does not matter how good the food, how adequate the food, if it is not digested, it will not be absorbed. And if it is not absorbed, it will not be assimilated. And if it is not assimilated, you will not be nourished. There are numbers of you that right now are eating more than adequate quantities of good food. And you're undernourished, you're underweight, you're weak, you're sick, and you're worrying about why am I sick? Why am I weak? Why do I not get stronger? Obviously, you're not utilizing, you're not appropriating the food that you eat. So the way in which we eat, or the circumstances under which we eat, is just as important as what we eat. And this means that the eater himself and his condition and his circumstances are as important as the food. I know that you have been told to eat this and that and the other, and it'll give you energy. It'll give you strength. It'll put weight on you. It'll do this and that and the other for you. And you've tried it. And it didn't do it. I was present at a meeting about 2 years ago when the head of a manufacturing firm that was manufacturing vitamin extracts, not the synthetic kind, the so-called natural vitamins, gave a lecture to a group of doctors on the subject of nutrition. During the course of his talk, he said, "I come into your offices, or my salesmen do, and we offer you our vitamin products. And we tell you that these vitamins will do thus and so. And you buy them from us, and you prescribe them for your patients. And the patients take them faithfully, and they don't do what we tell you they will do." Now, he said, "Why do we tell you those things?" You'd be surprised at his answer. Answering his own question, he says, "We tell you those things because those are the things you want us to tell you. I'm not telling you tonight the things you want me to tell you. I know that some of you want me to tell you that you ought to have a colonic irrigation. Others of you want me to tell you that you ought to take black trap molasses. And others would like to have me endorse your program of eating powdered skim milk, or taking brewer's yeast, or taking vitamin tablets of one kind or another, or some of the other products that are on the market, commercial products of one kind or another, such as chlorophyll products, amino acid products, and other products of that type. And you expect me to say to you that these things actually possess the nutritive value and the miraculous principles and qualities that the peddlers tell you they possess. And I'm not going to do anything of the kind. I'm going to tell you this evening just one thing about what to eat. And that is, take nothing into your mouth as food, except whole, unprocessed, unrefined, natural foods. From your fruit stores and your vegetable stores, from your nut stores, and from the other stores that handle such things. You won't get them, of course, from the meat markets. You won't get them in boxes and bottles put up by Kellogg and Company. Or some other company of that kind. What I want to talk to you about is not so much what you eat as how you eat it, the circumstances and conditions under which you eat it, because there are many circumstances that inhibit or that completely suspend for a time the processes of digestion. And the first thing I want to say in that regard is this. Eat when you're hungry and eat all that your hunger demands. There is no wisdom in the old advice to leave the table hungry. But I would emphasize another feature of this, and that is, be sure that you're hungry. Most of you have never in your lives experienced genuine hunger. Mother started you off, if you're among the older group here, mother started you off feeding you at the breast or at the bottle every 2 hours, day and night, by the clock. There never was a clock that knew when you ought to eat. Yes, they stuck you on milk and milk and milk, and then when you were so full of gas that you were suffering with a colic and you were screaming with pain, they turned you belly down on their knees and jounced you up and down trying to jounce the gas out of you. If you're still younger, they still fed you by the clock, but not so often. Every 3 hours. Or still younger, every 4 hours. But they fed you at night time too. The clock determined when you ought to eat. They even woke you up to feed you when the clock said it's time to eat. Now, that clock ought to be somewhat like the case of the old Negro who was working on the top of a tall building that was being constructed. The 12 o'clock whistle blew. He went over and sat down on a pile of lumber. And he said to most people, that's dinner time. But to me, it's just 12 o'clock. You should not be guided by the clock in your eating habits, but by the physiological demands of nature as expressed in the instinct of hunger. But inasmuch as you have never been hungry in your lives, because you started that program of filling up at intervals of during the day and night, very early in your existence, and you continued it on through infancy and on through childhood, on into young manhood and womanhood, and then on into adulthood, and you're even keeping it up in senility, you've never been hungry. Consequently, you think that hunger is a pain in the stomach, a gnawing feeling in the stomach, a feeling of weakness, an all-gone feeling. Some of you imagine that headache is hunger. These are symptoms of disease. They are not normal manifestations of life. They do not mean that you need food. Ah, but one of you say, if I have a headache and I take something to eat, my headache stops. And if you were a morphine addict and you didn't have any morphine and you were suffering all the tortures of Dante's Inferno and they gave you a shot of morphine, your aches and pains would stop. Does it mean that you needed morphine? Of course not. It means that you have re-narcotized your nerves in the one case, and that as a food drunkard in the other, you have done the same thing with food that you did with the morphine. You have palliated a symptom that you could get rid of permanently by missing a few meals and letting genuine hunger return. But we are a nation of food drunkards as well as other kinds of dope addicts. Genuine hunger is never experienced in the region of the stomach. The hungry person doesn't even know that he has a stomach. How do you think men and women used to eat in primitive times before they learned that there were such things as stomachs? How did they know when they needed something to eat? Genuine hunger is a mouth and throat sensation. There's usually a watering of the mouth. Often there's a distinct desire for a particular food. But it's not one of those neurotic desires that can't be satisfied with something else if the food you want isn't available. If you haven't got caviar, it'll take a crust of dry bread and be satisfied with it. That's hunger. If you've got one of these finicky appetites that doesn't want this or I don't like that, I mean now if it's wholesome food that you don't like or you're turning down, that's not hunger. Keep in mind that appetite and hunger bear the same relation to each other as a counterfeit dollar does to a good one. Not genuine. Be sure that you're really and genuinely hungry, and then eat. That should be your rule throughout life. It should have been the rule they started you with. Now I want to give you a few further rules that will help you to carry that one out. One of these I touched upon briefly last night. First, I want to say to you that if you have pain, I don't mean the little pain that might come from a pinprick. I mean a severe pain. The processes of digestion will be suspended. The glands in the walls of the stomach will cease to secrete digestive juice. The stomach itself will become motionless. You will not have any desire for food. None of the physiological conditions that are necessary to good digestion will be present. Therefore, when you are in pain, you should miss the meal. You're not hungry. You can't be hungry under such conditions. Oh, there are people who think they're hungry when they're in pain. There are people who think they're hungry even though they have had a full meal. There are people who eat as many as 20 and 30 meals a day and still continue to clamor that they're hungry. This is a condition that is known technically as bulimia, which means an ox-like appetite. These people, if they're not given food, will chew their own fingers. They'll eat up the bedclothes. They'll eat anything they can get their hands on. And some of you who imagine you're hungry under conditions when it's not possible to be hungry, are suffering with mild degrees of the same perversion of your appetite or of your hunger. You're suffering with the same kind of a neurosis, only in a milder form. A number of years ago, when I was on the staff of the New York Evening Graphic, and carrying daily articles on health in that paper, a young lady in Brooklyn threw herself into the East River in an effort to drown herself. She was rescued. It's against the law to commit suicide, you know. I don't know what they can do to you if you succeed, but it's against the law anyhow. She was rescued and taken down to the police station and questioned. Why did you try to kill yourself? And she explained that her sweetheart, who was a sailor, had been in port for 3 days. And he hadn't communicated with her. He hadn't called her on the telephone. He hadn't come to see her. He hadn't sent her a postal card. She had had no communications of any kind with her. And she thought that she had been jilted, and she didn't want to go on living. Well, the police got in touch with the captain of the ship and found out that the reason the young man hadn't communicated with her, he had been consigned to ship and was on duty, and he hadn't been permitted to go ashore. Well, the police explained the situation to the captain, and he let the young man come ashore. And he went in to see the young lady, and after they greeted each other in the usual style, he said to her, when did you eat last? She says, I haven't eaten for 3 days, Bill. I couldn't. Why couldn't she? Because under the emotional stress that she was in, she had no digestive power. Her digestive system was secreting no digestive juices. The motions of her stomach had ceased. She had no desire for food. Here again, all the physiological conditions that are essential to good digestion were lacking. And old Mother Nature cut off the desire for food, in self-protection, of course. And you may be sure that the girl's mother and the girl's father, and the girl's parents, and if she had a nurse and a physician hanging around, they too, and all the neighbors, urged her to eat. Oh, but you must eat. You starve if you don't eat. You must eat to keep up your strength. If she had eaten, instead of it keeping up her strength, it would have poisoned her. If you have a hard day's work and you come in the evening and you have a strong appetite or hunger, you sit down to a good meal and you have started to eat, and perhaps you've eaten a few bites and you're relishing your food, and the doorbell rings and you go to the door and there's a messenger boy there with a telegram, and you open the telegram and the telegram announces that your mother has just died suddenly. What becomes of your desire for food? It suddenly vanishes. The emotional condition that this announcement of the death of your mother or somebody else, or the loss of a lot of money, suspends secretion, suspends the activities of the stomach. So here again, all other physiological conditions necessary to good digestion are lacking. And to eat under these conditions is not to digest your food, but to have it lie there in the stomach, sometimes for days, to rot, to putrefy, to ferment. You know that we have these conditions in patients. We have a patient feeding him. He expects a visitor, let us say on Sunday. The visitor doesn't come. He has his noon meal, he's feeling all right, and he takes his noon meal. But 1 o'clock comes, and 2 o'clock comes, and the visitor doesn't show up. He begins to get anxious. And the visitor never shows up. A little while later, he begins to complain of having gas and pains in the abdomen. 24 hours later, a stomach pump can be used and bring up the contents of his stomach, and that meal that he ate at noontime will still be lying there in the stomach, undigested. Whereas, had he been poised, had he been at peace, that meal would have been digested in 3 to 4 hours, so far as stomach digestion is concerned. Under conditions of emotional strain and stress, omit your meals. One, two, or ten or more, if necessary. If it's grief, if it's anxiety, if it's worry, if it's fear, if it's emotions of strong emotions of any kind, if it's shock, omit your meal. You can't be hungry, and you can't digest your food under such conditions. You'll save yourself a lot of misery, a lot of suffering, a lot of trouble, a lot of disease by following that simple rule. If you have fever, if you have marked fever, just a slight bit, just barely enough to show on the thermometer, won't make a great deal of difference. But if you've got 1 or 2 degrees of fever, if you have a coated tongue, if you have a bad taste in your mouth, if you have a dry mouth, bear in mind that the condition of your stomach is the same as that. It's coated too. And the digestive juices are not being poured into the stomach and will not be poured into the stomach. There'll probably be a lot of mucus poured in there, but not food, or not digestive juice. The stomach, instead of carrying on its regular rhythmic motions, will be at a standstill. Don't eat. Summing this all up, we can put it into a rule of this kind. If not comfortable in mind and body from one meal to the next, miss the meal. Now that doesn't mean that if the discomfort passes off a half an hour before mealtime, you can go ahead and eat. I said if not comfortable from one meal to the next, miss the meal. If you're in pain, if you have fever, if there is severe inflammation, if you're emotionally distressed, miss the meal. If when the next meal comes around, everything is all right, if the pain has been gone for a considerable time, if the fever is gone, if you're emotionally poised and calm, then you may take the meal. Take it a light meal, but don't take a heavy one. But if it's necessary, miss 2 meals or more. There are people here in the audience that can tell you from their past experiences that you can miss several meals without dying. By the way, let's see your hands. Those of you who have had a fast of as much as 10 days. All right, let your hands down now. And how many of you have had a fast of as much as 20 days? All right, how many have gone 40 days without food? Well, I think most of you look like you're still alive. The undertaker hasn't gotten you yet. So you may be assured from the experiences of these people that if it becomes necessary to miss a few meals under conditions, under pathological conditions or under emotional conditions that render digestion impossible, you'll not die as a consequence of missing those meals. Remember now, under these conditions, you will not and you cannot be hungry. So miss the meal. Some years ago, 2 dogs were taken. And they were fed a meal of flesh. You know, we have an idea that dogs have to eat flesh. But they just couldn't get along without the filthy stuff. I have cats and dogs that eat corn on the cob, spinach, potatoes, tomatoes, various other types of vegetables and fruits. And they get along wonderfully well on it. They actually do better on it than they do on flesh. And particularly this canned dog food that you feed them today. There's no better way of killing your dog than feeding them on that stuff. But to go back to these dogs, they were fed each a meal of flesh of the same size, the same kind of flesh. One dog was chained to a tree and left at home. The other dog was chained to the rear axle of a buggy and taken out for a 4 hours fast trot behind the buggy. The trip was made in such a way that they went around in a circle and arrived back at the starting point at the end of the 4 hours. Then the meals were taken from the stomachs of these two dogs. The dog that had remained at home, lying peacefully and quiet in the shade of the tree and taking it easy, had almost completely digested his meal. The dog that had been tied to the back axle of the buggy and forced to trot at a rapid rate for 4 hours had hardly begun to digest his meal. Severe physical labor, athletics, or any type of heavy physical activity practically suspends the process of digestion. I know you say, but I can't work unless I have a good breakfast. I have to have a breakfast to give me strength for the morning, and I have to have a good noon meal to give me strength for the afternoon. But suppose you don't digest the breakfast in the morning. What strength do you get out of it? And suppose you don't digest the noon meal. What strength does it supply you with? And yet that's exactly what happened. Now, when do you get anything out of that meal that you eat? Well, let us see. It takes about 4 hours for gastric digestion of the average meal. And then about 12 to 16 hours for intestinal digestion of the meal after it gets into the intestines. That runs from about 16 to 22 hours, doesn't it? Then it's got to be absorbed into the bloodstream and carried by the blood to the cells and taken up by the cells and incorporated into cell structure before it can be used by you in the performance of work. How much strength does your morning meal give you for the morning work? How much does the noon meal give you for the afternoon work under such conditions? While you're working on the supper you had 2 nights before. Probably the only meal of the day that you really digested. Now, in the good old days of the past, we had a practice in this country that we called nooning. Some of you older people may remember the expression or the term, but laborers would come in from their work or from the fields, and they'd have their noon meal, and they'd go and lie down and rest. They'd even go to sleep. And they'd take a nap, and then they'd go out and go to work. It was somewhat like the siesta that they take down south of the border. Only it didn't last as long. Most of those siestas last 24 hours a day. They had better digestion under such circumstances. Nowadays, what do you do? They give you 30 minutes for your meal. Whether you're a worker or a school or a kid in school, you got 30 minutes to eat. So if you're a boy or a girl in school, you want to get out on the playground and play. So you bolt your food as rapidly as possible and you go out and you start running and romping and jumping and playing. If you're a working man, you get your food down as rapidly as possible and in a few minutes you're back on the job. Now, if you get sick eating in such a way, you know full well that it's not because you've been eating in a way that inhibits the digestion of your food. You get sick because a little bug crawled in under your toenail. Or one of them got through a crypt in your tonsils and got into your bloodstream, found its way to one of your joints and set up housekeeping, and you've got arthritis. In the good old days, of course, these bugs were all germs. Nowadays, the germs have some recruits. We have viruses. One of the nice things about viruses is that we know all about them and don't know anything about them. I once saw a description of the human soul. It said that it was out without width, that it was out without breadth or width, it was out without height, it was without thickness, and it was without weight. And a friend of mine reading that description of it said, that's the best description of nothing that I ever saw. And when I read the descriptions of the viruses, I think of his remark, the best descriptions of nothing that I've ever seen. But they have taken up housekeeping in our minds, at least, and helped the germs to displant or supplant our old belief in evil spirits as the causes of our diseases. We've never been willing to admit that we produce our own troubles, that we're the architects of our own diseases, the builders of our own miseries. We always want to shoulder the responsibility off onto something else instead of accepting our own responsibilities for the results of our own misconduct. In India, some years ago, the British Army was having a tremendous amount of illness. Minor illness, nothing so very serious. But a lot of the boys were off duty so often because of illness that they got to be quite a problem. So the commanding officer called together the medical heads of the army and he said, see here, there's something wrong. We have too much illness among these boys. Something has to be done about it. So they made quite an investigation and they came up with a little change in their program of feeding the boys that reduced the illness by 50%. Prior to that time, they would go take them out on long marches. They'd bring them in after a long march, march them right in to the mess hall, sit them down to the table and feed them. After studying this situation, they changed that. They brought them in from these long marches. Of course, the men were tired. They were fatigued. They sent them into their bunks, had them to lie down and rest a while. And after they had had a good rest, then they sent them into the mess halls and fed them. Just that simple process reduced the illness in those soldiers by 50%. Now why? Because fatigue inhibits digestion. Fatigue inhibits the outpouring of your gastric juices. It inhibits the action of the digestive system all along the line. Eating when you're fatigued is just as much a violation of the laws of life or the conditions of life as is eating immediately before you begin hard physical labor. If you are fatigued, rest first and eat afterwards. You imagine that if you're fatigued, that's a sure sign that you need food. You've been told that over and over again, that fatigue is an evidence that you're in need of food. Fatigue is an evidence that you're in need of rest. Of course, if you're thirsty, you know that that means you need a bottle of Coca-Cola. Not that you need a glass of water. And if you're fatigued, it doesn't mean that you need rest. You need some food. That's the idea. If you are fatigued, your energies are at low ebb. Your functioning powers are impaired temporarily. And it is rest, not food, that restores those functioning powers. A night of rest will restore your functioning powers after a hard day of labor, even if you don't eat anything all day long. But a heavy meal in the evening and a night of activity will leave you exhausted in the morning, no matter how good the food. Rest is the means of recuperation. Rest is the means of restoring functioning power when overwork and overstimulation have lashed you into functional impotency. Get the necessary rest and sleep rather than eat. And then eat afterwards when you're in a condition to eat. And you'll save yourself a lot of indigestion, a lot of distress, a lot of headaches, a lot of constipation, and a lot of worse miseries and diseases. And these things that I mentioned, these minor troubles like indigestion and gas and so forth, they are only the beginnings of trouble. The initial beginnings, the starting point. Diseases, as I pointed out to the other evening, do not come into existence full-blown. They begin in minute and imperceptible departures from normal function and normal structure, and they progress step by step and stage by stage as we continue our violations of the laws of life until they end in cancer or Bright's disease or diabetes or apoplexy or some other of the so-called degenerative diseases of later life, or until we're ushered into the henceforth by the poisons of the physician mistreating us for pneumonia or typhoid or influenza or something of that kind. People don't die of pneumonia or influenza or typhoid. They're killed by the treatment. The next thing I want to point out to you, I want to stress by you, is the necessity for chewing your food. I don't mean by that running it through a food chopper. I don't mean putting it into a blender and making it into a soup or a mush. I said chew it. When you cut food open, when you expose the inner portions of that food to the air, oxidation of food begins immediately. Run a head of lettuce through a food chopper, and in 60 seconds, which is just one short minute, you lose 80% of the vitamin C in that lettuce from oxidation. Slice your tomatoes in the ordinary way, and oxidation of vitamin C begins immediately. And within a few minutes, you've lost a great part of the food value. Not only because the vitamin C is oxidized, but because some of the rest of it undergoes oxidation. The more your food is hashed and cut, the more it is ground and pressurized, the more it is liquefied, and the more it comes in contact with the oxygen of the air, the more oxidation takes place, and the less food there is left in it. So you buy good food, and you pressurize it, you blend it, you hash it, you chop it up in small pieces, you grate it. How you love those grated carrots and grated beets on your salad. And then you let it sit for a while and then you eat it. It not only has lost its taste, it has lost much of its value. But you do these things because you're too lazy to chew. And you're too lazy to chew because you're living in such a way that you haven't got the necessary energy with which to carry on the ordinary functions of living. People are so lazy nowadays that if they've only got one block to go from the house to the store, they get in their car and drive that one block. No wonder you're too lazy to chew. You want a machine to do the chewing for you. And you can buy them at prices ranging from $30 to $100 and more. And who gets the benefit out of it? The manufacturers and the salesmen. You don't. One of your orange companies here in your state recently advertised nationally, telling you to stop making orange juice, but to eat the whole orange. Because in extracting the juice and throwing away the pulp, you lose a great deal of the food value of the orange. When I saw that, I clapped my hands and shouted hooray, because I had been telling my readers and my listeners that for more than 20 years. I have been telling them that every time you make tomato juice and throw away the tomato pulp, you actually throw away more vitamins and more minerals than you get in the juice. Some years ago, a man came to San Antonio and opened up a juice factory. He was peddling chiefly carrot juice, and he advertised it heavily, and he was delivering it from house to house all over the city. He was selling carrot juice. I thought the city of San Antonio was going to go down the drain from a Noachian flood of carrot juice. One day I went in to see him, and I said to him, "What do you do with the carrot pulp?" "Oh," he says, "I have a dairyman out here that comes and gets it to feed to his cows." And he said, "You know something? The cows that get the carrot pulp give more milk than the cows that don't." I said, "I'm not surprised. There's a lot of food value in that carrot pulp. It's being thrown away. You're wasting it. And you are being told by these fellows that fill you up with juice. You just guzzle juice all day long. You must take it by the quart. You're being told that you can't get enough minerals, or you can't get a sufficient amount of vitamins unless you take it in the juice form. That if you eat the food, you can't eat enough to supply your needs. Isn't it strange that after several million years on the earth that the human race has suddenly reached that point where it can no longer eat natural foods and be nourished by them? You've got to call in the chemist and the inventor with his gadgets to enable you to nourish yourself. But you can't digest those things. There's too much roughage in them. There isn't any roughage in them at all. There's a little bulk there, but no roughage. And there's not too much. Of course, you don't need it, a lot of bulk. There's a lot of people who want to feed you a lot of bulk. And in order to do it, they have you eating wheat bran. You take some whole wheat bread, perhaps, and there's some wheat bran in that, but you put some more bran in on your cereal in the morning or something, or put it onto something. You put it on your salad or somewhere else. And if that isn't enough, you take some agar-agar or some psyllium seed or a combination of both. You do that, of course, to guarantee that you have good bowel action. And you know what it is? It's working on the old hay baler principle. Those of you who have lived in the country or been in the country and seen the process of baling hay know that they cram all the grass down into the baler and compress it together in making the bale of hay, and then the baling wires are tied around it, and it goes down a shaft. Pushed down a shaft. It's just pushed a few feet. The next bale comes along, they make it, and it goes down the same shaft. And the second bale pushes the first bale along towards the end of the shaft. And then they make the third bale, and that's pushed into the shaft, and it pushes the first two bales on down the shaft. And after a bit, the first bale falls out on the end of the shaft. And that's what you're doing by taking all this bulk. On the old hay baler principle, you're pushing one meal out with the next one. And you work on the...
Turn the cassette over and enjoy side B.
You're not satisfied unless you're goading those poor old bowels of yours. You work on the principle that life is supposed to consist of being continually filling up and emptying out again. You're not satisfied unless you're goading those poor old bowels of yours with all kinds of things. Somebody sent up a question last night that came up after we had retired for the night. Wanted me, if I could remember it this evening, to tell them what is the cause of constipation. Constipation is due to enervation. And one of the best things I know to produce enervation is an eating program of that kind. Now, let me tell you this. You're constipated if you can't have normal bowel movements on a diet of bananas and water. There's no bulk, no so-called roughage in those bananas. You're constipated if you have to do anything to force your bowels to move. And that kind of eating is enough to tire and fatigue anybody's colon. If you'll chew your foods, and if you don't, before you swallow them, they won't be chewed because your stomach has no teeth. Oh, yes, if you were a cow or a deer or a buffalo or a sheep, you could graze all day long and swallow the food without chewing it. Then after you've filled up, you could go and lie down under the shade of a tree and take life easy, regurgitate the unchewed food and chew it and re-swallow it. That's commonly called by the farmers and the stockmen chewing the cud. Sometimes a cow stops doing that and they say she's lost her cud. She never had one to start with. It was the food she ate that she brings up and chews it because she swallows it originally without chewing it. But you don't have four stomachs like the cow. You can't do that. Chew your food before you swallow it. Now, I didn't say give it 75 chews. Or 32, or any such thing. But chew it well. And that doesn't mean that you have to sit there for 2 hours to eat a meal that you could easily take in 15 to 20 minutes. You don't have to be so slow about it. You know, in watching patients that have been on a fast, I discovered a long time ago that the people who chewed their food and ate it as though they were afraid to eat, and took an hour and a half to 2 hours to eat a small meal, never made any gains. The person who ate the same meal and ate it with gusto, ate it like he relished it, went after it like he meant it, and chewed it well, was the man who gained weight and strength. So I wondered if anybody else had made the same observation. I asked Dr. Esser. I asked Dr. John Curcio if they had seen any such thing, and they both confirmed my observations. It doesn't mean that you have to spend all day at the table in order to chew your food, but chew it. It'll actually help you to get along without overeating. The more you chew it, the more sure your body is to say that's enough at the right time. But if you swallow without chewing it, if you give it a lick and a promise and let it go, if you wash it down with water, with milk, with coffee, with beer, or with something else, without chewing it, you're not only going to overeat, but you're not going to digest it well. You're going to suffer with indigestion. Drinking with meals is a very popular American habit. Now, when I say American habit, I mean that part of the American population that came either directly or indirectly from Europe. When our European ancestors arrived over here, they claimed this continent by right of discovery. The inhabitants that were here ahead of them didn't have any rights. They hadn't discovered the place. But nonetheless, they claimed it was theirs, so we set about to prove to it that it didn't belong to them. And after we had pillaged them and plundered them and murdered them, why then it was ours by right of conquest. So we've still got it. But those particular people weren't in the habit of eating with their meals, of drinking with their meals. The so-called backward peoples, the so-called savage peoples, and the only reason we call people savages is to justify killing them. It's all right to kill a savage, but it's not so good if you kill a civilized individual. That's the reason when we go to war with somebody, we picture them as the beast of Berlin or some other kind of a beast. You don't fight human beings when you go to war. You fight dagoes, or gringos, or greasers, or terrible Turks, or something of that kind. And that's the reason we picture them as something evil. When you get to know them, you find they're just like we are. And when they will go to war with us, the boys that manipulate their minds and send them out to do their fighting tell them the same things about us. One thing about the rulers of the world, they know the kind of hokum to feed the so-called common people to get them to do what they want them to do. To kill and be killed in order that they may keep their boodle. So we killed them off. But they didn't need to drink with meals. Neither does the animal drink with its meals. I've seen cows stand for an hour at a time eating a meal made of cottonseed meal and cottonseed hulls. And I can think of nothing that one could eat that would be drier unless it's hay that has been dried for months. And I've seen them stand by the hour and chew hay and never go out and get a drink while doing it. And horses will do the same thing, and other animals. They moisten their food with their saliva. And that guarantees that that food will be digested. And you have to wash it down, again because you're too lazy to chew. With water? No, most of you don't drink water. That's bad. But you wash it down with some kind of a fluid without chewing it, without insalivating it, without even tasting it. You don't even know how good food can really taste because you never get a taste of it. You perhaps taste the coffee as it washes your food down or something of that kind. Now, when you take these fluids into your stomach, the first thing the fluid does is to dilute the gastric juice and the saliva. It not only dilutes the juice, it dilutes everything connected with it, the enzymes as well. And if it happens to be water that you take, it goes out of the stomach in about 5 to 8 minutes after you swallow it and takes the juices and the enzymes along with it, leaving the food without the necessary enzymes to bring about their digestion. So in washing your food down, you not only cause yourself to overeat, but you produce a condition that makes efficient digestion impossible. Cut out that folly of drinking with meals. And I don't care whether you call it mint tea or alfalfa tea or some other kind of a tea that you take with your meals. It should not be taken with those meals. I told you the other night that there's only one drink in all this universe. There are all kinds of fluids that you swallow in the same way. No, it's not whiskey. In the same way that you do the only drink in the universe, water. Everything else is either food or poison. Your fruit juices and your vegetable juices, your milk, your soups and gruels and so forth that you swallow like you do water are foods. And your Coca-Cola and your beer and your whiskey, your coffee and your tea, things of that kind are poisons. There is only one drink, and that shouldn't be taken with meals. When should you drink? Well, the real reason for drinking is to supply a need for the body, a need for water. And that body of yours knows when it needs water, and it'll manifest that need in thirst. But you have forgotten how to interpret your sensations, how to interpret your instincts, how to interpret your demands. So you're just drinking and guzzling at all times. And you've been taught to do it. You must drink so many glasses of water a day, whether you are thirsty or not. 6 glasses, some of them say. 8 glasses, some of them say. Once when I was on the staff of the Graphic, I received a letter from a man in Savannah, Georgia, telling me that his physician had advised him to have 23 glasses of water a day. He wanted my advice about it, and I wrote back and told him I thought it would be a lot of trouble drinking 23 glasses of water a day. If he'd just go down to the firehouse and have the boys turn the hose down his throat, it'd save him the trouble. I know people who never drink any water at all. They get all the water their body needs in the juices that are in the fruits and vegetables they eat. But you can take all the water you want 10 minutes before your meal. You can take all the water you want 30 minutes after a fruit meal, if you want any. You can take all the water you want 2 hours after a starch meal. And you can have all the water you want 4 hours after a protein meal. The old rule was, take water 2 hours after meals. If you take water 2 hours after a protein meal, you fill up your stomach with water at a time when the digestive juices are there in greatest abundance, when the digestive work of digestion is going on at its highest degree of efficiency. You dilute the juices, you wash away the juices and the enzymes a few minutes later when the water passes out of the stomach and digestion comes to a standstill. Starch digestion will have been completed in 2 hours. Fruit will be out of the stomach in 30 minutes. Normally so, some of you people don't get rid of your fruit that rapidly. I mean, it doesn't pass out of your stomach that rapidly. So, you might have to wait longer. But don't take the water with your meal. Now, finally, let me urge you to eat moderately. Now, what is moderation? The Greeks had an adage, moderation in all things. That's an impossibility. I hear people use that old Greek adage when they're trying to justify their use of tobacco. They take it moderately. When they justifying their use of whiskey, they take it moderately. They justify their use of beer, they take it moderately. Nowadays, you're being told that moderation in smoking will not cause lung cancer. You're being told also that pipes and cigars are not part of the cause of lung cancer. In other words, loopholes are being left so that you can still go on smoking.
and the tobacco industry can still pile up its millions out of your degradation. Now, what is moderation in such things? Let's put it another way and see if we can't make this thing clear. What is moderation in murder? How many men or women, either way, can you kill a year and still be within the bounds of moderation? What is moderation in theft? If you're a horse thief, how many horses a year are you permitted to steal and still be within the bounds of moderation of theft? What is moderation in arson? If you're a firebug, how many houses can you burn down in a year and still remain within the realms of moderation in arson? And what is moderation in rape? How many rapes can you commit in a year and still be within the bounds of moderation? Don't you see how foolish it is to say be moderate in all things? Especially when they put the emphasis on all. Moderation is properly applied only to the use of those things that have a normal relation to life. You can be moderate in the use of food, or you can be excessive. You can be moderate in the use of sunshine, or you can be excessive. You can be moderate in the use of water, or you can drink excessively. You can be moderate in exercise, or you can exercise excessively. You can be moderate in the use of anything. That is an essential of life. But when you get out into those fields where you're trying to use something that is not essential to life, that has no normal relation to life, that the body cannot make use of, there's no such thing as being moderate in it. Nor is there any such thing as being excessive in it. Any amount that you may use is wrong. But when it comes to food, there is such a thing as being moderate in the use of it. How can you do it? You gluttons. I see women in particular. Very few men ever try to reduce. Very few fat people ever reduce anything but the food supply.
There's a story that George Bernard Shaw and G.K. Chesterton once met in a restaurant. They were sitting on adjoining stools in a restaurant in London. And Chesterton, you remember, was a great big boy with elephantine proportions. And Shaw was built like a beanpole. Chesterton looked at Shaw and said, "From the looks of you, one would think there's a famine in the land." And Shaw said, "From the looks of you, one would think you are the cause of it." But you see, these fatties undertake to reduce. And do you think they do it? Who said yes? Well, they usually don't. They stay with it, their reducing program, for a day or 2 days or 3 days, and then they start eating again. And I see them lose 5 pounds in a week and gain 10 the next. Because they have never been taught from their infancy up self-control. They have never been disciplined, and they have never been taught to discipline themselves. They have been taught to indulge, and they do. So they have no conception of what moderation may be. They don't even know when they get enough to eat. The only time they know when they've got enough is when they're so full that they're uncomfortable. After they have loosened their belts by 2 notches, then they leave the table and they're uncomfortable and they groan and they grunt. And they belch.
And then when they get large, they pat themselves on the abdomen and say, I believe in plenty of good nourishing food.
I remember the president of the chiropractic college in San Antonio.
He's dying now of diabetes.
He was always a foe of dietetics. Well, most of the old chiropractors were. They believed that if you just keep the kinks out of your spinal column, you could digest tenpenny nails. During World War I, B.J. Palmer actually published information about where to adjust for cooties. And he used to get up on the platform, and he was nice and rotund, you know. And he'd strut up and down the platform, and he'd pat himself on the abdomen. And he'd say, sure, I believe in diet. I believe in lots of diet. He's paying for it now. He's probably 2 years older than I am. But he's dying of diabetes. And his spinal adjustments don't do him any good. He tried a magnetic healer, and that didn't help. He went out to the Spear Sanatorium in Denver. And Spear has diabetes, too. And that didn't help. So he went to a medical hospital, and that didn't help. So there you are. He believes in lots of good food. He never cultivated moderation. Now to make moderation easy, those of you who have never learned to control yourselves, you've never learned to say no. You know, Dr. Clonch, some of you here knew Dr. Clonch. I think the medical boys killed him. He was hit by a hit-and-run driver up in Washington a few years ago, and they never did find the driver, nor the car. You, Dr. Clonch, I think the medical boys killed him. He was hit by a hit-and-run driver up in Washington a few years ago, and they never did find the driver, nor the car. And I think it was done purposely, but that doesn't matter. I couldn't prove it. He used to say that the finest exercise in the world, and particularly for reducing, was to go up to the dining table and put both hands against it and push back just as hard as you could. But so many of you can't do that. You remind me too much of St. Thomas. He was so big that he had a circular place cut out in his table so he could get in to reach his food. Too many of you are headed in that direction. If you will eat more of the fresh, juicy fruits and of the succulent green vegetables and less of the concentrated foods, you'll find that you won't be so likely to overeat. You can eat more of these, so far as bulk is concerned, without overeating. When you sit down to a starch meal, if you'll have your salad first, eat the whole salad. Then have your cooked vegetable, if you're taking cooked vegetables. And in the meal with your starch, you can eat, in most cases, all the starch you want, enough to satisfy you, without overeating. But if you eat your starch first and take all you want, you'll fill up on an excess of starch and leave half your salad in your plate. When you sit down at your protein meal, do the same thing. Have your salad first, then your cooked vegetables or other raw vegetables, if whichever you're eating, and then eat your protein. And you can eat as much as you reasonably want, and you'll not be overeating. But if you fill up on protein first, and take all you want of it, and then go over to eat your vegetables and your salad, you'll leave part of your vegetables and half your salad, and you'll get too much protein. A little simple trick like that will help you to be moderate in your eating habits.
Now, those of you who have gone on a raw food diet recently find that you're eating too much because you're trying to eat raw foods in the same quantities that you formerly ate cooked foods. Now, why do you eat so many foods when you eat cooked foods? Because you have to. The more they're cooked, the less food there is in them. And you have to eat 2 and 3 times as much as you should in order to get enough food to nourish you. You live on the raw portions of that food and keep yourself sick on the 2/3 that is thoroughly cooked. You still try to eat the same quantities when you go on uncooked food. And you don't get along too well on it. You quit, you give up. These uncooked foods are not good for me. Try eating them in smaller quantities. We do not derive benefit from our foods in proportion to the quantity that we eat. On the first night of my lecture here, there was a young fellow here who now lives in your state, but who was then a resident of Dallas, Texas. And he was, like a lot of young fellows, quite wild. And he had been out with the wrong young woman, come up with an infection. And he was up in Milwaukee on a radio program. And he wrote me about it. And I wrote him, explained to him what he should do. And after a time, he wrote back to me and he said, I'm not getting along very well. I'm eating solids by the tub full. And I'm still not making any progress. And I wrote back and I said, try taking the solids by the thimbleful and see if you don't get better. In 2 weeks, I got another letter saying, I'm doing fine now. I took your advice. I'm not eating so much. That is one of the mistakes we make when we go on these various diets. We work on the principle, the more of a good thing, the better. And it's not true. It's simply not true. If you go on a juice diet, you'll get a lot more benefit out of it if you only take 3 or 4 glasses a day than you will if you take 3 or 4 quarts. In other words, the more closely you approach a fast, the more value you will receive from that juice diet. Now, you'll be told that that's all wrong by men who never conducted a fast in their lives, by men who know very little about fasting, and by men who never tried the program of feeding juice in small quantities. They think the more they can pour into you, the more benefit you'll derive from it. They want to alkalinize you, and they want to do it in a hurry. They want to give you a lot of minerals, and they want to get them in there right now. They don't realize that the urine test a couple of hours later will show that they're being passed out. They want to give you plenty of vitamins, and they want to crowd them in there so fast that you can't make use of them. Overcrowded nutrition leads to trouble, not to improvement. And that's what they're trying to do, overcrowd your nutrition. That's what they are doing. And they'll tell you that I'm wrong. But they've never tried the other side. They'll tell you that I'm wrong when I tell you that enemas and colonic irrigations are not only not necessary, but that they're positively harmful. How many of them ever tried caring for their patients without enemas? Not one. I have used enemas. I used them very faithfully during the first 5 years of my practice. I was taught just as they were taught, that they were beneficial, that they were necessary. I gave them up after 5 years. For 28 years, nearly 29 years, I haven't used them. What kind of an experience has theirs been? Very one-sided, very lopsided.
They have not tried both sides. How do they know I'm wrong? I challenge them to give it a test. I have never seen one single doctor of whatever school that has abandoned the use of the enema that ever went back to it. Or the irrigation, either one. Now, I'll say on the other hand that if they'll just try this program on their juice diets of giving their patients juice by the thimblefuls instead of the tubfuls, they'll discover that they're getting better, will get better results. Because here too, moderation is more important than gluttony. Tomorrow evening, I'm going to fulfill my promises. You've asked me many questions about many troubles. Arthritis, asthma. I don't believe anybody said anything about hay fever. And various other troubles. And I have put you off with brief answers, telling you that I'm going to give you a detailed reply to all those questions Friday. Friday, we're going to discuss recovery, not cure. I hope none of you send me up a question tonight asking me, will fasting cure anything besides hams? I'm not going to discuss cure for you tomorrow, but I am going to discuss the means and measures that will enable you to recover. I'd like to see every one of you in your seats promptly at 8 o'clock. Of course, I know you won't be here at that time. Don't think that you're unusual. It's this way all over the United States. It may be all over the world. In New York, you announce a lecture for 8 o'clock, and if you get started before 9, you're doing good. Well, anyhow, try to get here early so we can get an early start. Tomorrow evening's lecture is very important, and it will take longer to do justice to the subject than I have devoted to this subject tonight or to the subject last night. And I'm sure you'll have many more questions tomorrow night, and I'll try to answer them all because it's going to be our last evening. And I want you to feel when I get away from here that you really got your money's worth. Now, as a means of assisting you in getting your money's worth, and a means of assisting you in increasing your knowledge, and assisting you in remembering what you have been taught tonight, I'm going to again do something that I don't like to do. You know, Benjamin Franklin put on the duds of poor Richard in order to toot his own horn. And I don't like to toot my own horn any more than he did. But I'm going to call your attention again tonight anyhow to those books over there on those literature table. There is one book over there that I have not mentioned to you at all during the course of these talks. And that is Volume 1 of The Hygienic System. I didn't mention it because I didn't think most of you needed it. That volume deals with the care of the healthy body. The care of your eyes. There are eye exercises in there for those eyes of yours, those of you who want to get rid of your glasses. The care of your skin. The care of your teeth. The care of your colon. The care of your feet. And the care of the other various other parts of your body in a rational way. Some years ago, they opened the tomb of King Tut in Egypt. And in there, they discovered that the Egyptian women used to paint their fingernails. Right away, you had to start painting your fingernails because the Egyptians in the reign of King Tut did. That's one of those incidences where history repeats itself, isn't it? Volume 2 of the hygienic system deals with diet. It is about as complete a volume on diet as you can get. One could write a library on diet without exhausting the subject. And there are bigger volumes on diet than that one. I see volumes on diet that are 4 times its size and cost $12 to $15. And I look them through to see what's in them. And I wouldn't carry them home if they gave them to me. So much value there is in them. From all over the United States and Europe, I have received letters from people who have purchased that book, and they have said I have read hundreds of books on diet, and now finally I have found one that tells me something about diet. I'm going to throw the rest of my dot library away. I told you I don't like to toot my own horn. Volume 3 is on fasting and sunbathing. There's 2 sections. There are many good works on fasting, smaller works and larger works. But that, I believe, is the most complete and most thorough and most practical work in English that is in print at the present time. And there's the little book on food combining. There's a lengthy chapter on food combining in Volume 2. There's a little book, The Introduction to Natural Hygiene. Which will give you a clear picture of the hygienic system as a whole. Finally, there is the book, The Hygienic Care of Children. Some of you young children could take that book very profitably and use it in bringing up your parents. Others of you could use it in bringing up your children or your grandchildren. If you have some grandchildren, you might present it to your daughter. Then there is the book that Dr. Wilburn says is the best book I ever wrote. I don't know whether he's a good judge or not. Health for All, which he's got on the table out there. I believe I have a few copies. I'd like to call your attention to these books, and I urge you before you get away tonight. You're not leaving right away. We're going to have our question period to get some of those books, or all of them if you want them. Finally, let me remind you that tomorrow evening after our talk, those of you who wish to remain for a few minutes, we would like to have you do so that you can meet with the members of the Los Angeles Natural Hygiene Society that will be present that evening. Some of them are here now and some have been here every evening. And if you would like to become members of the Los Angeles Natural Hygiene Society and thus become a part of a movement that is already nationwide and that we intend to make worldwide, we'd like to have you remain and hear of it with us. We voted in Chicago at our convention in July to hold our national convention in Los Angeles in 1956. We're going down to Washington next year and see if we can straighten out that muss down there. I was there in April lecturing, and it had been suggested to me, more than once, of course, but it's been suggested to me, it had been only a short time before that I run for president next time. And I told them there that I had none of the qualifications required to be president. As a vegetarian, I don't fish. As a hygienist, I don't smoke. As a busy man, I have never learned to play golf. Now, how can I be president? All right, now if the ushers will take up those tickets while we stand up and stretch a little bit while we get started with the question. You know, after I let you get up to stretch, a young lady walked up here and said, "You know what you said is true. I just got all of your books a short time before you came here to lecture. And I'm getting rid of all the rest of my library." He hasn't started yet. Wait a minute. Give him a chance. Feeding a baby a raw vegetable, so forth. What is the best system of feeding the baby?
Can you make that word out? No, I can't, but the man wants to know how you're going to feed a baby.
Carrots, unless you grate them.
How are you going to feed the mother foods unless you grate them? I told you the other evening that there's only one book in existence that tells you how to feed babies. It's out there on the table. Babies should not be fed carrots, nor should they be fed vegetables. So long as a baby does not have the necessary tools with which to chew its food, it should not be given food that requires to be chewed, nor should you chew it for them. I remember, some of you older people here will remember the practice too. I remember the time when mothers used to take food in their mouth and chew it and then take it out and give it to the baby. Well, you're doing the same thing now with your graters and your fletcherizers and your blenders and so forth. Except you don't insalivate it in the process. Babies should be given milk. And if they need any supplement to that milk, if you've got a healthy, well-nourished mother, milk is all they need. If you're feeding them cow's milk, or if there's some doubt about the mother's health or about the quality of her milk, then supplement it with fruit juices. Orange juice, tomato juice, grape juice. I've used all kinds of juices. Watermelon juice, mango juice, papaya juice, plum juice, cantaloupe juice. I've used all kinds of juices in supplementing the milk. And give it to them in a bottle. Strain it and give it to them in a bottle just like you do the milk. But they should have nothing but the milk and the juices until they are 24 months old, 2 full years. It is not until then that they have a mouthful of teeth. Now, I didn't tell you to start feeding them carrots as soon as they first tooth comes through. One tooth is not enough to chew with. They do not even have the diethylamine in their saliva with which to digest starch until they're 24 months old. They do not have the necessary starch-spitting enzymes in the intestinal and pancreatic juices until they're that age. Let's take your... Coconut milk is all right. Yes, I've used that too, and it's all right. Chocolate lava.
Alfalfa is a neutral, nutritional speaking. Why don't you become acquainted with this fine food?
Recently, while I was in Chicago, I made a talk on the hygiene of motherhood, and I criticized the use of hypnotism in childbirth. And I was present as chairman that day, a man who is a hypnotist and a hypnotic consultant. And he'd had some experience with hypnotism and childbirth. And he got up and he pleaded with me to investigate hypnotism. I actually began my investigations of hypnotism before he was born. I don't know how old the gentleman is or the lady who sent that question up, but I investigated alfalfa and all the other things that you people are so fond of a long time ago.
Why do you oppose lemon juice on a green salad?
If you're going to eat a green salad and nothing else, go ahead and use the lemon juice. If you're going to eat a green salad and have a protein, remember that your acids inhibit the outpouring of gastric juice. If you're going to have a green salad and a starch, remember that that same acid destroys the ptyalin in your saliva and stops your starch digestion. Simple as all that.
Is a 10-day grape diet of real value in relieving cancer?
I have never seen anybody recover from cancer on a grape diet or on any other kind of a diet or on a fast or in any other way. If they have cancer and you're sure it's cancer, then they don't recover. If it's on the borderline, if it's a diagnosis of cancer, then recovery is...